What I said something for you. This gym is nice. Hey, you have the nicest bathroom gym in the world, man. You think I want to take a picture there? Look like a Pulp Fiction, nah. Hey, if I open a gym, I'm gonna call Ryan, come for make my style here, man.
No.
What's the nicest gym I went to this last year?
Do you remember the story you were telling me about when you were a white belt?
Oh my God, man. Are you talking about Carson Gracie? It's funny, we have here the match. Imagine this wall here behind you. This is exactly the size of the bathroom. The bathroom have like this kind of door, yeah. This door have like the plastic. It's not like a wood, it's not like a glass. And of course, during the fight here, the guys, boom! Break the... They break the door. It's exactly when you sit, like Adam sit down here, yeah. The door was break exactly his face here. Like, you training here, you see? Oh my God, oh my. No, having things about jiu-jitsu a long time ago, you can't believe. We are all, yeah.
Well, at Hickson's studio in West LA on Pico Boulevard, that was it was an old karate studio, but the bathroom was gross. It was old, you know. But it wasn't his. It was he was renting out space from an old karate studio.
This is the place before you fight.
But Gracie Torrance was like this.
Yeah.
And I left Gracie Torrance to go train at Hickson.
The one he come with the bicycle, go in the back, is this that one?
Yeah.
One of my goal, my dreams in a long time ago is that I come to United States, he stayed there, I trained there with him. Hickson always was my inspiration. You know, we are from, Carson broke from Grace Academy after 1980. Mm-hmm. We fought, it was the last year I fought to Grace Academy. In 1981, when he go to fight in independent, Grandmaster Eric don't allow him to put Gracie. So the name of the gym was Carson Academy. No Gracie, Carson Academy. In this year, Hollis, Eric, Carlos was the president, vice president. I think he's technical director. Is Hollis.
When did you start with Grandmaster?
Okay, when I started jiu-jitsu, I started with Carson.
Oh, well, both.
Okay, I started jiu-jitsu in 1969 because it was very, very close of my house, João Alberto Barreto.
Okay.
Yes. João Alberto Barreto e Álvaro Barreto. Né? João Alberto was the older, né? It's the same time que Carson. And a gym called, this building called Edifício Kennedy at Santa Clara, where I live. E Carson have in another street called Figueiredo Magalhães, where my grandmother's house is across the street. Mm-hmm. I live in Copacabana all my life. Jiu-jitsu was like make part of, everybody know about Gracie, everybody know about, because we have like Pinduca, all this guy. Carson was he's a referee for beach soccer, football.
Yeah.
E Carson was referee.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Referee.
Yeah. Because I brought Adam to this, if you don't understand, he have like 2 years the Ricardês.
No, I understand, but that's the first time I heard referee. But every other word I know.
Yeah, good. And everybody know about jiu-jitsu. Everybody have like the Gracie is very famous in Copacabana. And I started at exactly with Carson in 79.
At the Gracie Academy.
At Carson, yeah. I go direct to Carson. I really don't know if you have this kind of Gracie or Grace.
When did you stop training with Joel?
Sorry?
When did you stop training with Joel?
Oh, he changed it. Okay, good. Alvaro Barreto, we don't have car, we walk. And my mom was bringing me to the class. He moved to another place far, like the same thing from here to Highland, but you need to walk. And my mom, though.
So when you started, was it privates only?
No. Was a group class. Carson was one of the first ones to have a gym with open class. I think open class was not just about jiu-jitsu. Karate, judo, all this martial arts was in group. Just the Gracie program, the original, was private class.
Yeah. Okay, so that's not how you started.
Because number one, the Gracie program was very expensive because the value is very important because the teacher spend 1 hour with you, né? Specific with you, go again, no, make you. I believe a lot that this is the one the great assistants, but of course it's not everybody can have the money. Mm-hmm. And what's happened is like this customer was the first one have a open class with everybody together. And I changed to Carson in 79. In 80.
How old were you?
15.
Okay. 15. So you started at 5 years old?
When I went the first time at Alvaro Barreto, I have 6.
Oh, okay.
I'm 64.
Wow.
I say 69, I'm 70. 70. I say 90. 79 was with Carson.
Yeah.
1970 was João Alberto Barreto.
Yeah.
79 was Carson. Yeah. Between this, we moved from Copacabana to Barra da Tijuca. This is where coming my nickname, Ricardo da Barra. I moved to Barra in 78. Sorry, 77. Oh, too much dates. 77. And
you're 55 or 56?
55.
Okay.
I'm 64. 1964.
Oh, 1964.
Yeah.
Okay.
And in Barra da Tijuca, don't have nothing in Barra da Tijuca in this time. Nothing. Have our condo where Silvio and Marcelo live together too. And we take the bus. I remember I take 3 buses for go to the jiu-jitsu. Drop in one place, get another bus, down another bus, for make shortcuts. The closest gym to my house in this time was Reilson Grace.
Okay.
Because the Barra da Tijuca, São Conrado, Gávea, Leblon, Ipanema e Copacabana. Então, look at this. Então, the closer, if for the parents, you know, you have like a 15, 13, or you move around the bus, they look for your safety. He's not going to allow you to get it too far.
Yeah.
The most, they look for the most closer. In this place was the first time I have private lesson. At the Houston Grace Academy is the original
Grace program. So you trained some with Grandmaster Houston?
Between, yeah. Houston. Okay. Houston was
exactly the first to leave the Grace Academy, right?
I don't know exactly the history, you know, to understand. I have association, and also I support a project in Fortaleza, in the north of the country, where I think one of the Graces there was Gaston Grace was there too. Mm-hmm. We have this kind of, I think Gaston left Grace Academy. I think in the beginner, they don't just try show how jiu-jitsu efficient, but they try to improve it. So in the north, they have very tough guys. They look for teach these people for bring it to the Vale Tudo, né? Mm-hmm. The Vale Tudo was the leverage for proving, because you look for the Gracie skinnies, the small guys, yeah, which is big. They accept a challenge against anyone, principal biggers, 2-3 weight divisions.
Yeah.
But you talk about private, at Houston was private class. I mean, it was expensive class. And I start for having more classes, I start helping him.
And so how old?
How old I am, was in 77, 13.
Okay.
13. Okay. I was at Houston for his start, because my school was across the street of his place, you call Shopping da Gávea. Né? And I just need to finish the class. I go there, I train, I got the bus for Barra da Tijuca and left. Then I met Paulo Strauss. Paulo Strauss is the today red belt. Paulo Strauss was his instructor, and the teacher there. And it was him who motivated me to go to CARS, because I want to compete. I want to train. And it's not about being competitive. I want to train. I want to do Vale Tudo. I want all history. Né? I grew up with these people around me talk about this. And
so is Joe Moreira there with you too?
Joe Moreira, the only thing we have to connection to Joe Moreira was at Judo Master. Sensei Meiji. No, not this time.
Oh, okay.
I know he did that too, but it's not this time.
Oh, okay.
I left to Paulo Strauss was Caio Terra instructor too.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah. Paulo Strauss.
Really?
Yeah.
I thought Hazen gave him the
was his instructor, not Tokyo was his instructor too.
Gotcha.
It's very, very nice, very, very, very good.
Yeah.
All these people, if you put more older, older black belts, they come from the same place. Technically, we talk about the same people who was training for the same Gracie.
Yeah.
And when I went to Copacabana.
Were they all taught by Elio?
I'm gonna tell something for
you. Because a lot of people say no. So I know when I was when I was at Ken Gabrielson's school for a while, one of Heusen's black belts, he told me Carson said no, he was taught by his father, by Carlos Sr. But then I saw a video with Heusen, who is number three, and Heusen said Elio taught everybody.
Oh, wait, tell something. I never see this video, but I have the same conversation with Carson. Technically, Carson, because it makes sense, the history of Carlos Gracie was the first one to learn, he teach you all, but they technically about like one starts maybe a couple of years after another one. Carson never say nothing about it. He said he was trained by Carlos. It makes sense, it was his dad, was the first one. Carson também put because he's the older brother, between 21 brothers, he's the first one.
Yeah.
And he said, I train Carley, I train Hollis, I train all these guys. And if you see the list, Carley, name him Clark Lacey, dad.
Yeah.
I believe, what did I say?
Carley says his father taught him.
Try to understand, everybody, the same thing you hear. This is your gym, but you say, God, boy, teach you out here, okay. You're going to say, okay, I'm Ryan's too, but Ricardo teach me here. I think it was the same thing. Everybody was in the same the Grace Academy.
Yeah, okay.
Probably is under the supervision or under the same program that Master Carlos e Hélio building.
Yeah.
Carson, Heilson was one of the youngest, you see in his biography, he say he was the youngest instructor inside the, he was very, very good. He talked good.
Oh, I've spoken on the phone with him for hours.
Yeah. I believe he's very, very good structured in this time too.
Yeah.
It's difficult to say like I say, the school is Grace Academy. The master was Carlos e Hélio Gracie. I don't know if Carlos at this time was less inside the teaching, more inside the building for organizing because Hélio was still fighting.
Yeah. Yeah.
Carson fought for the last time in 1970. He had 45 years old. It was the fifth time he fought against Odemar Santana.
Grandmaster Carlson was your age when you came to him in 79.
Yes. Yes, exactly. 45 with my five, yes, exactly this. You know the funny about Carlson? His spirit and his personality was so young. He always short, shirt. You know, Grace had black hair. It's not see Grace's
white hair. When I met him, he was all gray hair. I met him, he was almost 7 years
old. And he all looked like it. When he died, my friend, hey, Diogo, call me. Because I have a tournament in Vegas with his name in Parump. Parump is a city 80 miles from Las Vegas.
Yeah.
And everything was ready. We talked in the phone. He said, Ricardo, I got a flu, I don't want to fly it now. Let's go put this for next week. It would have been February when he died. Né? And they say, I come next week for stay with you, you do the tournament. Okay, all right. And he called me. Né? I can't believe it, because in my mind, Castro was like young. I say, but he's 45. He said, he's 45, he's 63. Like, oh my God. You know, his personality is younger.
Yeah.
He is. We talked this in the last Saturday. Now we have a first time reunion. The all black belts from Carson. Have a graduations. A couple of friends got a red, white, black, red. It was a good moment with everybody. And everybody can get the belts. Have a couple of minutes for talk. Everybody talk about his personality. Né? Carson was like, if it was today, I think the scenario of jiu-jitsu will be different. But in the beginning, when you sit down here, we talk about, why you left Vegas, what this? We see today the expansion of jiu-jitsu go like a business. Like a business, I'm going to say, wow, the people do a great job. You see so much franchise, so many brands, all the time news.
Yeah.
More and more, you see this transition between black belts. The one team changing for another one. Carson was very strict of this because for one factor, he never he never was attached to this about money.
Yeah.
He never cared about this. So I think when you put money between anyone, between me and you, friends, family, create a
division. Well, if you make it an issue. And that's, isn't that how several of the black belts left, was because
about money.
He let them train for free and he taught them everything. And he says, okay, now that you're making money, you know, how about you bring me on as your manager or something? And
the issue is, if you go to Murilo, he was the first start with him, was the person who could give a the true, the right explanation about this. It's not like so simple like this. You want more, people don't want to pay more. It's a lot of things, you know. Everything depends on how you start. Right? When you somebody close your door, you show your problem, you say, this is the way I run my class, my gym with my students. Somebody come to you, say, I want to be your affiliation, I want to be part of your team, say, this is the way I do my affiliation. Do you like? Yes or no? Yes? Okay. I think it's important to principle today, after all this experience we have, and you know about the past. We don't spend the same. You talk about 20 years ago, we don't expect it will be so big like that.
Yeah.
I went to, before I go to Brazil, I went to the World in Las Vegas. I get out with my friend, one of the guys own the gym today, he has like a brand new Corvette. You get out inside the convention center. For 1 second, I get out of his car. I look for the, I say, man, like make like a move. I see myself arriving very, very far, cheaper, the old stadiums. Like, you got hours for arrive there in the bus with your gear and your sandals, and maybe just a couple of coins for you come back to home. And you fight there, you need to choose between or medal or diploma. You stay all day long there for fights, you don't have any kind of the luxury or air condition. And today, we see this and say, wow. For me, it was like I'm so grateful to be alive to see this transformation.
Yeah.
Again, about money, né? Everything go different today. What I see from this primitive times about it, we got a bus, go far away for fight. And today, what I see now, could probably, and this is already start, they look for no more association, but like a teams gonna stop by the black belt from another place. They already have to take this project in alliance. They accept curriculums, and if you accept, you come, you have a place for stay, everything. Technically, like a soccer players.
Yeah.
You change if you don't make your expectation inside the team, they don't renew your contract. What they see is like this: the professional gonna have a professional teams gonna hire black belts around the world.
Do you like that?
I'm gonna tell something. I cannot say it was a great idea. Like a businessman, I'm gonna say, wow. This, but like why I come to jiu-jitsu, why I still with my mind, why I was so involved in jiu-jitsu. In the beginning, like I told you, I never expected to be a professor. I want to be black belt. I graduated I did stock market. I worked in the Definition. I worked in the like Wall Street. Nah? This was my profession in Brazil before I be a jiu-jitsu professor. We don't expect this. Então, we still have this romantic vision about jiu-jitsu, dojo, family, master, respect. You are like my brother. Castro was like my father. The person que I come there not just for position. I come there sometimes for emotional support. I come for guidance, you know, because life is like this. You don't go all the time up all the time. I have moments like you need somebody for help you.
Yeah. So I started in 1989, and in the 90s, I was in California. But I started Hawaii under Halson and then moved to California. In the mid 90s, we might have had one tournament a year if we were lucky. Joe Morera did the very first one that I remember in California. And then the Machados did one, I think. It was Hickson versus Machado. And then, so then back then, it was you're part of a team. And when I moved from Hawaii to California after college, I called Grandmaster Halson and I said, where should I train? He tells me, you can train with any of my brothers. He goes, and you're okay. He goes, but if you train with somebody who's not my brother, I disown you. So I'm like, okay. So Gracie Academy and Hickson, that was it.
Yep.
And it's always, you know, it was like that for a long time for me. But and even in the mid-90s when we'd see videos of the tournaments in Brazil, right? It was at that time, it was Jacare, Hoyler, Carson, and Gracie Baja, or Baja Grace, right? Those are the four teams. But when you watch them compete, all different styles. Carson's team, I remember, was very much the bigger, stronger guys and the smash kind of guys and very aggressive jiu-jitsu. And I remember Gracie Baja was very loose, very tricky type of jiu-jitsu, right? That's what I remember seeing. And I would see that kind of stuff, but then now you have everybody just kind of doing all kind of stuff, right? But they just call themselves still the same team. And then you have one black belt at one team, and 5 years later, he's a black belt at another team. And then 5 years later, black belt at another team.
Yeah.
And, you know, and I know that, you know, some of you have one name and then the school is run by a black belt from somebody else. And it's like, you know, I thought I'd go to this school, I get this style of jiu-jitsu, but no, actually you're from there, right? It's not a team anymore. It's a team only in name.
Exactly.
Right?
Again, like you say, imagine you say in the 80s, exactly these 90s, it was, we have one tournament a year. One tournament a year.
Was that the Copa or the Brasileiro?
No, the Federation, before coming Company, before coming Copa Atlântico Sul, World Division. This one tournament a year, because number one, the Federation have money enough for rent a nice stadium where our academies around. Mm-hmm. You need to get a stage far, more cheap, whatever. One tournament a year. Second, between 80, 81, Hollis die. If for 1 year we don't have tournaments, the federation don't collect money because we don't have too much competitors. The schools don't say, like today, everybody need to pay the IBJJF or pay the membership for keep it going. Então, the federation don't have money. Então, what's happened? Joey Moreira, Claudio, they start create the Atlântico Sul. Another big clothing company in Brazil called Company. They got to start supporting. We got a couple people start making tournaments. Better terms. Why? The term was they give you t-shirts. This is coming with t-shirts. T-shirts. They make medals. They make trophies. They make advertise about the fight. The fight was in nice places, bringing more people. You see, bringing more people, bringing more attention, bringing more businessmen, people's interest in invest. Was the time that everything started to be a little professional. People give support.
Yeah.
Pay, you ask for support or sponsor. The guy give a new gear for you, he pay your register, like $100 for compete. And things go this way. You talk about Barra Grace. When Hollis died, another thing happened. His students was very attached to him, like a brothers. They, if I don't have Rollins, I don't want nobody. Nobody accepts somebody. Nobody better than him. Someone's moved to Carson. But like you say, Carson have a school with different styling. Not just the training, but the people. You know? People from Hollywood was more young, surfers, skaters, guys. No, the guys more in the castle was people more to make it. It's different people, different tribals. Yeah. Different, I don't want to put names. Yeah. Né? And Jacaré, né, Romero, he opened a gym called Master. Was in a corner of my ever before I stock market, I start opening car sales. I buy sales, used cars. Mm-hmm. And it was Teixeira de Mello, Rio Visconde Pirajá, Master, second floor, small, maybe half of your gym here, you know, and coming very good purple belts. Fábio Gurgel, Peckles, Gigi, all these guys coming from there. This was the time que Gurgel started teaching jiu-jitsu in another place we call the Club Federal. And long story short, all these people start teaching different places. Mm-hmm. And they coming together. Mm-hmm. And mm-hmm. change the name for Alliance. We don't have too much, let's say, you don't have too much gyms. It was important, the purple belt, the brown belt is expanding for different areas. Like I told you, some parents, some
Foxy
people.
Foxy went to São Paulo, right?
Oh, it's late, later.
Oh, much later.
Because he was purple belt, I'll talk about. You know?
I only met him when he was a black belt.
Yeah,
he
no.
He would come to the U.S. and he trained with Hickson.
He's very. He has a brother called Rodrigo. His sister, I forget his name, his dad is Mr. Gugel, bought her first car in my store. No, we are very close. And what's happened is, this guy start teaching one place, another one. What was important for this? Start grow the number of the competitors or the students. Mm-hmm. You can come the idea to make tournaments. We have more people, because before it was just in one location, another location. Some people cannot travel for that because I told you, parents not allowed you got the bus. Rio de Janeiro is not a so safety place for young kids who all move around. Some parents don't allow, no, you're not going too far away. If you want maybe a couple blocks, you can go the bicycle, you can walk, but that place need to take too much bus. Was important they open different gym, different locations. This was to start coming the expansion.
Yeah.
The tournament started to be better. But the big blow was when the Vale Tudo, 1992, against Jiu-Jitsu, against Luta Livre.
Yep, that was Fabio Gugel, that was Murilo Bustamante, mm-hmm. and Valide, right?
Yeah. The original was four. Was Fabio, Murilo, Valide, Marcelo Berg.
Marcelo
got a very bad injury in the knee. He's supposed to fight against Hugo Duarte.
Oh, okay.
I went to Hugo Duarte last Saturday. Yeah. And
Fabio fought him, right?
No, he fought against Denilson. Denilson was bigger than him.
Oh, so Hugo Duarte did
Hugo Duarte was, oh. He was very sad because technically everything started with him. Everything started with Amaury Valide. They went to a TV channel in Brazil. And they repeated the old slogan for Jiu-Jitsu. We fight against anyone, anywhere, any division, no time.
Was that before or after the Luta Livre guys went to the Gracie Academy?
This was after. Hickson was already left, yeah. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. This is why coming to me all this, that they accepted. Hickson was left after the second fight against Hugo. The first time they went to the academy was not the Luta Livre. Flavio Molina have a kickbox called Naja. Naja. Naja Academy at Catete. And one of his students have a fight with Helium in Teresópolis. He beat up him. And Charles walking Copacabana, I think of me, on the street. And they match in the street. Charles was young. Yeah, the guy was older. The guys take him and he come back to the gym. Hollis immediately got everybody with him. You don't ask everybody to go with him. Everybody go with him. When he get out, everybody follow him.
Yeah.
And they went to the Flavio Molina place. And this was the first start of the...
And when was the beach?
The beach was years after.
Hickson at the beach.
Yeah, the beach. Because my son, I remember, Renzo brought the VCR. For watching my house, and my son, I think he was already born, 87, huh? Yeah.
Was that 87?
Yeah, 87. This thing at Molina's Academy was in the 80s, 1980, for sure, for sure, for sure. I remember the year. But after this, Lawrence died.
Yeah.
I think what's happened is all this kind of Holly was the best, the number one. After this, Holly died. All the time, the new sheriff wanted, everybody wanted to be the number one, you know?
Yeah.
All this kind of, in the beginning, everybody was young, you know? Today, everybody's friend. I think it was, I like more about it. In 1987, if I don't be sure, my son was already born, Hans brought, was the fight in the beach. After this, we were returning to Great Academy, to Maitá. For they think he was not prepared, was in the beach, the people's coming, he want to be like, okay, let's go now face to face, start. And Master Hickson beat up and he say, you okay, you done? Say, done. Say, you okay, done. Don't. They left. But when the
why was Valide there?
Because when they come to the gym, they come with you, all Luta Livre.
Yeah. And like 40 guys, right?
Yeah, people call for a backup, you know? It's normal. People don't have a cell phone this time. If you have a cell phone, Facebook, gonna be maybe more. And they come to it. What's happened is they fight, and the people was around, because everybody did agreement that nobody never was jumped.
Yeah.
Just want to keep it, everybody open. It, between here, he pushed there, he coached Hugo Duarte, he coached Hicks, people start talking,
Yeah.
This coming, but was the problem was not Valide, I thought Valide was there. The problem was Hoyler and Eugenio have the argument during the fight, because this, they come back again next day. This is on YouTube, if you find. They close the door, put the chairs back, like that wasn't the same floor, like you floor.
And that was Hoyler and Virginia?
The shoes, floor, and speed of the fight.
I saw a video of that at Helson's house.
Yeah.
Virginia and Hoyler. Yeah. That fight just went on and on and on.
Yeah. Punch, kick, punch. Yeah. Hoyler always was very brave. Eugenio is strong.
Yeah.
Box background. I think his daddy was a boxer too. Again, all these people today are friends. Everybody learn with Chad. Today we learn a lot. Everybody training no-gi. In this moment, like I say, we are young. Everybody want to be the tough one. Huh?
Yeah.
But we talk about the what I think about today is this is good. I think we cannot stop the progress. It's not about what I think. Like I said, I have a romantic vision about jiu-jitsu. I really like it the way it was before. I come to the gym not just for learning jiu-jitsu, I come because my friend was here. I have emotional support, The people kind of like be with me. What I see today, I see guys coming. They don't care about who you are. You are good training for him. He just wants what you have. Let's go train hard, finish by, It's not somebody maybe you can call and say, I have a bad day today. No, I don't have time for you. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So what I see, it's not, I don't have control about this.
Yeah.
People run business, You survive and you have competitors around us or you follow the, I'm very glad that I have today with me, in my association, my students, in my form, my teammates, I still have friends.
Yeah.
I think it like us, like a structure, I think it, this is what I try to do. I try to pass this image about Carson.
Yeah.
What make us be there. It's not just because Carson was the best. No. He gave you this. He gave you, it's every day there. It's like you laugh like crazy. He always have something funny for say. He's a positive guy. I cannot remember one person who don't like Carson.
Yeah.
I think.
That's one thing I noticed. I've met a few Carson senior black belts and the loyalty that they have to him, it's like nobody else, right? And that's one thing I noticed. And then Carson senior black belts always say Carson senior, right?
Yeah.
That's my master, right? And whereas you don't always see it with other master, grandmasters. They're loyal to the grandmaster, but not that kind of loyal. Not like he's my father type of loyalty.
Like it to again, one more time, right? Yeah. Last side you have the reunion. If you see the list of the old black, red, white, the red, all these people was engineers, marshals, doctors, everybody had a profession. Everybody was there. At one point, everybody had college, everybody had a good job. We married, we have life, but we never miss a class. We make all time for go there for be with cars. It's not about competition. It's not about being number one. I think this time was different. You see people today, they ready, have an example, my students. After high school, they stop, going to be professional fighter, going to be professional jiu-jitsu, going to be professional teacher, whatever. They ready to take the sport like a business before everything. And at the Carson Gracie School, all these people, they do everything that was necessary. Our parents don't allow us to train all day long, no. We need to go to the school, we need to go to the college, we need to get a job, we need to get married. So you try, and you need to split, you need to separate your date and come to training.
Yeah.
The difference today, you see, wow, a Brazilian is, you know, Brazilians or Americans or any people, you know, the difference between today, like you, in Brazil, you have people ski training all day long. They do like sessions morning, afternoon, and 2 at night, maybe like 6 o'clock at night, or they want like 10 o'clock at night. In between this, they lift weights, eat, sleep, run. They, this why you see the professional, the black belt in the United States, everybody needs to work. Yeah. The more you try in the beginning, you need to, you don't have sponsor, you cannot live from just for jiu-jitsu.
Yeah.
So in the beginning, he needs to go to school, he needs, yeah, he needs to work. So the difference between Zach there is that in Brazil, very early, if the guy wants training, he training all day long. So the your hours in the match there is double.